Hello everyone, welcome to another lecture of on thermodynamic relations and gas mixtures. I am Anubhav, assistant professor in IIT BHU. So just to give you outline, we'll start with Maxwell relations, then we'll also talk about Clausius Cloperan equation and Joule-Thomson coefficient. We'll also talk about briefly about gas mixtures. What are some basic laws and how to get properties for a mixture using component properties. Okay, so let us begin with Maxwell's relation. So what is the significance of Maxwell's relation? So basically we know entropy is a very important property, but that cannot be measured directly. Okay. And Maxwell relations give us relationship between entropy and other properties like pressure, temperature, volume, etc. So the advantage of this equation is that we can measure change in pressure, temperature, or this property volume, and using this change we can calculate what is the change in entropy. So that is why it becomes very important, because it gives a direct way to calculate entropy. Okay, so before we go to the derivation of Maxwell's equation, let us have a look at some mathematical background, some basic differential maths required to derive this equation. So let us begin with a simple function z, which is a function of x and y, and let us assume that z is a continuous and differentiable function. Okay, so can I write it like this? So basically what I am doing here is that I am differentiating z. We are doing a partial differentiation, and I am differentiating z with respect to x, keeping y constant, and I am differentiating here with respect to y, keeping x constant. So this is what you can do for a continuous and differential function. Now let us denote this term as m. This term within this bracket, let us call it m, and this bracket we'll call n. So can I write my function z in this form? Dz is equal to m dx plus n dy, where m is del z by del x and n is del z by del y, as we have defined here. Fine. Now let us differentiate it further. Let us differentiate it again. So what we'll do is we'll differentiate m with respect to y. Okay. So what we have is we have del square z by del x del y. Similarly, we'll differentiate n with respect to x. So we have this. Now if you look at these two carefully, what you see is that they represent the same fraction, only this order of differentiation is different. But if we have a continuous and differential function, these both are same. So what we can say from this is that del m by del y is equal to del n by del x for this function. Okay, so this is what we needed to derive Maxwell's equation, and we'll just keep this in background, and once we cover the thermodynamic aspect, then we'll invoke this equation and use it to derive Maxwell's equation. Moving on, so let us now look at some thermodynamic background. So we'll be using U internal energy, H, which is defined like this. We'll also define two more properties. What are they? So first is the Helmholtz function, which is defined in this manner. U is the internal energy, temperature and entropy, and another function is Gibbs function G, which is defined as enthalpy minus TS. So we will look into four Maxwell's equation, and for that we need four relations. So one will be for internal energy, that you'll see in a moment. Secondly, we have an equation for enthalpy, Helmholtz function, and Gibbs function. Now let us begin with U. So this is a direct result from TdS relations, what we studied in entropy. So du can be expressed as TdS minus PdV. Now let us differentiate this equation, and we can when we get du, we can replace the value for du from this equation. So doing that, we can write dh is equal to TdS plus VdP. So we have just simply differentiated it and substituted du by this RHS of du. Okay, so this is what we get for dh. Similarly, dA can be written in this form. So again, I have differentiated this equation and substituted du from here. So we get dA. Now for the Gibbs function, we'll differentiate this and substitute dh from here, this equation. So we get dg is equal to minus sdt plus vdp. Now these four are called Gibbs relations. Okay, and this forms the basis. So using this, we'll derive Maxwell's equation. So let us have a look how. So let us begin with the first equation, first Gibbs equation. du is equal to TdS minus PdV. Now going back to the mathematical background, what we discussed a few slides back. So we talked about this function z, which was represented as mdx plus ndy, right? So can you see some parallels here? Or can I say that u is a continuous differential function and I want to map this equation in this? What I mean is, I can say that I can map my u as z, t as m, minus p as n, s as x, ds as dx, and v as y. So you see what I'm doing here? I'm mapping this two equations, okay, and we see that we have an equivalent form. Now remember what was the final equation we derived in that slide. So finally we come to a conclusion that del m by del y can be equated to del n by del x. So if you don't remember, you can go back to that slide, but this is what finally, this is the relation what we finally derive. Okay, so I want to use this for du. So what I will do, del m, what is my del m? Del m is del t divided by del y. Del y is v. Okay, so del t by del v at constant s is equal to minus del p by del s at constant v. So for you can actually see, you can match one to one and see that this is what it represents. Okay. By using this equation, using this identity or result on this equation. And this is my first Maxwell's relation derived from du. Now similarly, we'll use other three equations and we'll come to this form. So let us look at it them quickly. So the second Gibbs function, Gibbs equation is for dh. So dh is equal to tds plus vdp. We'll map again. Similarly, we'll follow the same procedure. Dz is equal to mdx plus ndy. So h will be mapped to z. T is m, v is n, s is x, and p is y. Right. This is the result what we have. If we apply this result to this equation, this is what we'll get. And this is Maxwell's second relation. So it shows relation between, so all Maxwell's relation will see that they are giving relation between pressure, temperature, volume, specific volume, and entropy. Okay, moving on, let us look at dA. So again we'll draw parallel and we'll try to map in this fashion. So dA becomes dz minus s is m, t is x, minus p is n, and v is y. We have this identity. I will use this for this equation, and this is what we get. This is third relation of Maxwell. Similarly, let us look at the last Gibbs function, dg is equal to minus sdt plus vdp. We will consider dz is equal to mdx plus mdy. So my g becomes z, minus s becomes m, t becomes x, v becomes n, and p becomes y. I will use this relation or result what we have derived, and we get the fourth or last Maxwell relation. Okay, so just to summarize, so these are the four Maxwell relations we derived from Gibbs function, and what they are doing is basically they all these equations have terms relating using differential of pressure, temperature and volume, and how they are related to entropy. This is the highlight. This is what we want to get. This is what we want to extract from Maxwell's relation. How S varies with these properties. Okay, moving on. Let us now talk about Clausius-Clapeyron equation, which is a very useful equation for phase change of a pure substance. So let us begin with third Maxwell's relation. So this is what we have derived previously. So let us look. So this is what we are talking about, third Maxwell's relation. Okay, so we have just changed the order. Now, for a saturation curve, P is a function of temperature only. Okay, and this is independent of V, volume. This we have discussed extensively when we are talking about in the lecture of phase change. Okay, so if you are not sure, you can go back and check in that lecture. So we see that pressure and temperature become constant. You can change only either pressure or temperature, but pressure is a function of temperature only. Now, with that assumption, what we can do is we can treat this as a dp by dt, and we can integrate this. So if I integrate delta del s, I get between gaseous and liquid phase, I get Sg minus Sf. Similarly, when I integrate del V, it becomes Vg minus Vf. And this is here only. Okay. Now, what are these two? So Sg minus Sf is, I can write it as Fg. And this bracket I can write as Vfg. So what we see, dp by dt for a saturation curve can be represented as Sfg divided by Vfg. Okay. Now, let us consider this equation for dh. In that equation, if I consider p is constant for a phase change, we have already seen that p pressure remains constant for a phase change. So for that scenario, this last term will be 0, and if I want to integrate, I can integrate between a liquid and a vapor phase. So dh and tds. If I integrate that, I'll get h of fg is equal to ts of t is also constant, and s becomes difference between gaseous and liquid phase, which is sfg. So what I can write from here is, using this, I can say dp by dt for a saturation curve is equal to Sfg divided by Vfg. This is what we have from here. If we combine these two, okay, so basically what we are doing here is we will replace Sfg for using this equation. So we get dp by dt sat is equal to Hfg divided by T into V. This is your Clapeyron relation. Okay. So this is the first step in deriving Clausius-Clapeyron relation. And this is written in the forms of Fng for vapor and liquid. But this is, we can write a more general form like this. So where one or two are different phases. So this is the same equation written in a more general form. You can also use it for solid vapor equilibrium. Okay, it still holds good. Moving on. So this is what we have derived in the last slide, Clopton equation. Now when for low pressure, so we the volume of a vapor will be much higher than the volume of a liquid. So we can assume that volume of liquid is almost negligible. So VFG will be equal to VG. Now with that assumption, I can I also assume that it is allowed to use ideal gas law here. PV is equal to RT, which is not strictly speaking true, but it can be used as an approximation. So using that ideal gas approximation, I can say that dP by dt sat, which is the LHS, can be written as PFG PH FG by RT square. So basically I am replacing V from here using PRT, PRT. Okay. So I can do some rearrangement, and what we can do is we can send P on the denominator of this side LHS, and we can bring DT on RHS, and we can arrange that with T square. So same equation with some rearrangement. Now another assumption we can take is that for small temperature intervals, for small delta T, I can assume that my H will be constant. Okay, assuming that, I can integrate this. So what we get is log of P2 by P1 is approximately equal to, because of so many approximations we have considered, we say that HFG by R, R is anyway constant, HFG we have assumed to be constant. And then integrating this, we'll get 1 by T1 minus 1 by T2 for the saturation curve. This is your Clausius-Clapeyron relation. And this is very useful for phase change applications, and it is used to determine the variation of saturation pressure with temperature. Okay, so we'll not go into detail on how to use, but you should know what is Clausius-Clapeyron equation and what are the assumptions involved in deriving that. Now let us talk about the Joule-Thomson coefficient. So we'll consider a throttling process. Okay, so when fluid is passing through a restricted passage, a porous plug, or a capillary tube, this is what we use for throttling. We have talked about throttling when we discussed about refrigeration cycles. Okay, so as a fluid passes through restrictions or get throttles, pressure decreases. Enthalpy remains constant. This is what we discussed in detail. Now, what happens to temperature? Temperature may increase or decrease or remain constant. What happens? We don't know for sure. Now, then how to determine what happens to the temperature? So to find out, we can define a constant, which is our Joule-Thomson coefficient. So which is defined in this way. So mu is del T by T, del P for constant H. So basically what we are seeing here is that mu or Joule-Thomson coefficient is defined for a constant enthalpy process, which is there, the enthalpy is constant, and we are measuring or we are estimating what is the variation of temperature with variation of how temperature varies with pressure. Okay, so we can find out the change in temperature by looking at the sign. So if this is the same we have for neglect, you can write mu or you can write mu jt, they represent the same thing, Joule-Thomson coefficient. Now if this mu is less than 0, what will happen? So we know that pressure is decreasing. So if pressure is decreasing, temperature will increase because their ratio is negative. Similarly, if for a decreasing pressure, temperature can decrease if this is positive, which is shown here. And if this is zero, then temperature will not change, it will remain constant. So if you also look carefully, what you can notice is that Joule Thomson coefficient is the slope of constant H line for a TP diagram. If you draw a PT or TP diagram, nu is the slope of constant enthalpy lines. Okay, so this was about Joule Thomson coefficient. Now let us have a quick look on gas mixtures. So let us begin with some definition. So there is a Dalton's law for additive pressures. What it says is that the pressure, so basically we are dealing with, we are talking about mixtures. So when we have a mixture of two or more gases, so how to determine pressure for a mixture? So Dalton's law states that the pressure of a gas mixture is equal to the sum of those pressure each gas would exert if it existed alone in the mixture temperature and volume. Okay, so let us look at it in an equation form. So what it basically says is that PM is the mixture, pressure of mixture. You just need to sum P individual pressures from each gas. Okay, so PI is the partial pressure for each gas. So let us look at an example. Let us say we have two gases A and B at some volume temperature, and P and PB are the partial pressures. So if you add these two gas, if you make a mixture, so your final pressure will be equal to sum of these two. Now what is the assumption here is that volume and temperature remain constant. So they are starting with, they are at T and they are at T only. But if the volume remains constant and within that volume I mix two gases, pressure will become additive. I will add these two pressures to get the final pressure. This is the essence of Dalton's law of additive pressures. Moving on, another law is Amagat's law of additive volume. So what it says is that the volume of a gas mixture is equal to the sum of the volumes of each gas would occupy if it existed alone at the mixture temperature and pressure. Or we can say that Vm is the volume of the mixture. So this is basically summation of individual volumes of different gases. So let us look at it an example. So we have gas A with volume A, Va. Gas B at some volume, if you add those, if you get a mixture, then the volume will be added, and this is basically for constant pressure and temperature. So if you maintain the pressure and temperature constant, then the volume will be a sum of individual volumes. Okay, so this is the essence of Amagat's law of additive volume. So another question is that when we have mixture of more than one gases, how to get other properties? So we talked about pressure and volume. Now what about other properties like enthalpy, entropy and all that? So similarly, they also will be added. Okay, so extensive properties of a mixture we can find by adding the contribution by each component. So let us look at an example. So suppose I want to find U is the internal energy of a mixture, M subscript is for mixture, and I is for individual component. Okay, so for a mixture, I just need to add all the internal energies for different gases. That's all. So U is the extensive property. I can use intensive U, and I can use either, I can talk about either in terms of mass, weighted mass, or molar basis. Okay, so this is how you can calculate U for a mixture. Similarly, we can also get enthalpy, entropy and other properties. You just need to sum over all the components. Okay, so with that, we'll stop now. And these are the different references which I've used. And I've taken some images from Singer and Bowles books. And you can also read these two reference books, Bornak and Sontag, and Pekinar. So with that, I will stop, and thank you for listening to it patiently.